Welcome back, structural geology fans. Today is a big day as we hit on one of the most important skills for a field geologist, the ability to take measurements on structures and put these measurements on a map that lets other geologists know exactly what you saw out there. To begin, layers of rock are basically planes of rock, and faults and joints are basically planar breaks in rock. And even with a fold, we can imagine a plane of symmetry, and thus measuring planar features is key to our science. A place on a plane can be described in just two intersecting lines, but we go a bit farther to not only say where we are on the map, for which you can go back to the beginning of this series to review latitude and longitude or the USPLS system to get your location, but today we are going to learn how to represent the orientation of any plane in 3D space at your location on the map. To do this, we use the concepts of strike and dip. A strike is defined as the direction of the line made by an intersection of an imaginary horizontal plane with the plane of the structure in question. To simplify this discussion, let's focus on a layer of rock which has been taken out of its original horizontality and tilted in some direction. If we were to submerge our tilted layer in water, we would see the horizontal water surface intersecting the dipping layer in a line. We use our compass to measure and report the direction of that line. And at the Colorado School of Mines, we teach our students to prefer use of the Azimuth System. This is the system that goes from 0 to 360 degrees around the compass rose. North is 0 degrees. East is 90. South is 180. West is 270 degrees. But wait, there is a problem here. Looking at our water intersecting our rock layer, we see that the strike line is just that, a line, not a directional arrow. So in this case, with the strike line going exactly north-south, we could call it 0 degrees for north or 180 degrees for south. Again, at the Colorado School of Mines, we teach our students a consistent method, and honestly, all geologists should start following suit for consistency and ease. We use what is known as the right-hand rule. First, you need to figure out which is your right hand. Then, put the fingers together and the thumb out at a right angle to the fingers. Now think that your fingers are heavy and want to go down the slope you are measuring. With the fingers of your right hand going down the slope of the plane of interest, your thumb will point in the one direction out of the two possible to use for the strike. So with our example with a strike line that is going north-south, we see that a right-hand rule would tell us to measure the direction to the south. In other words, we put the strike here as 180 degrees, not zero. Besides this strike azimuth number using the right-hand rule, we need to measure one other geometric aspect of the bed, its dip. The dip of a planar feature is the maximum angle between the plane and our imaginary horizontal surface. I have to say the maximum angle of dip is any angle measured that is not perpendicular to the strike. Will be less than the true dip of the bed. One way to quickly assess this dip direction is to actually, or imagine, pouring water on the planar surface and seeing or imagining which way the water would run. That is basically the dip direction, as water will tend to take the steepest angle down the face. For our previous example, the strike was 180 degrees and the dip is 45 degrees. In our notebook, we can quickly write down our location and 180/45. With that, we have the orientation of the plane in question. Note that I could say that the bed is dipping 45 degrees to the west, but I don't need to as long as I use the right-hand rule. To repeat, we use the fingers of the right hand to point down dip, and our right thumb, at a right angle to the fingers, points us in the correct strike direction. Put your right thumb pointing in the direction of strike, and your fingers will be at a right angle in the direction of dip. So with a 180/45, we know the bed is dipping 45 degrees from vertical to the west. If the strike and dip were 0/45, that plane would be dipping 45 degrees to the east. Now that we have the concept of strike and dip using azimuth coordinates and the right-hand rule, let's see how it is measured in the field. Now, we'll cover basic field equipment in a future episode, but here we introduce you to the use of the compass in field geology. Near the beginning of this series, we discussed the use of compasses and orienteering, so we already saw that a map and compass are essential tools of the geologist. But the compass is also how we measure strike and dip. Professional geologists prefer the Brunton Field Compass, as it has the ability to freeze the compass needle, has more precise gradations, has a bubble level, has a dip indicator, and all the extras needed for sighting and surveying. However, these are usually over $300 US, so may I recommend that any beginning geologist just go out and get a relatively cheap compass, but be sure that it has a dip indicator on it. The Sylvan Ranger compass does many of my beginning students very well. The only thing I do to adapt the Sylvan Ranger is glue a small bubble level on its face as so. With a circular bubble level, we can make our compass as close to horizontal as possible. Recall that strike is the line formed between the plane of interest and a horizontal surface. With the bubble level, we can make our compass the horizontal surface, and when placed with the long edge against the plane of interest, we can take the strike in the right-hand thumb position. Once the strike is recorded, we can put the long edge of the compass along the steepest dip direction, and with the Brunton, we adjust the dip dial with the bubble level, and then we can read the dip angle. With a cheaper compass like our Sylvan Ranger, we need to put the east and west markers in line with the phosphorescent markers used for orienteering, and the free-hanging dip indicator now gives us the angle of dip. 0, 45, 90. Let's practice this on a nice, flat face of this statue. We first determine which direction to take strike with the right hand. So step one is to remember which hand is your right hand. Place your right hand with the fingers going down slope and your thumb at a right angle points us in the proper strike direction. Now take your compass and make it as level as possible, then place the long edge right up against the slope you're measuring. Turn the dial to put the red in the shed, that is, the large orienteering arrow on the dial is moved under the magnetic north arrow. Now read the azimuth degree number that is aligned with the tick mark in the direction of strike we figured out with the right-hand rule. In this case, the strike of this surface is 190 degrees, a bit west of due south. To get the dip, which is going to have to be towards the west, we align the east and west sides of the dial with our opposing orienteering tick marks, determine the steepest angle of the slope. If needed, you could pour some water on the surface, but you should start to get this down without using that trick, as water is of such value in actual field work. We place the long edge of the compass against the slope in the direction of this steepest dip, and now you can use the free-hanging dip indicator to read the dip. In this case, the dip is about 56 degrees due the west. With the right-hand rule, we don't need to note the dip direction, as it will always be 90 degrees to the right of the strike. Why do geologists shell out more money for a Brunton-style compass? Well, first, it comes with a level already. We have more precise and easier-to-read dial gradations, dampers to reduce the swaying motion of the needle, a hold button to freeze the needle in place to make it easier to read, and the dip indicator is controlled with a bubble level that can be put into proper measuring position and then removed from the surface to read the dip. With a Sylvan-style free-hanging dip needle, you have to crane your head to read the measurement while the compass is still against the planar surface. Now, both varieties have a mirror, which can come in handy when you have to measure above your head and still read the compass or in other odd angles. But those Brunton extras are just really nice to have, but not absolutely necessary. So whichever route you take will get you your data. But how do we represent this data which has location and orientation components? We place a symbol on a map at the location where the measurement was taken, so clearly it is important to know how to read a topographic map, which was covered at the very beginning of this series. Assuming all viewers have gotten up to speed with locating themselves on a map, we can move on to how to draw the symbol for strike and dip at that location. The basic symbol is a T-bar, with the long bar representing the strike and the short bar the dip. If, as usual, north is at the top of your map, then a north strike, that is 0 degrees azimuth, would be drawn as a vertical line straight up and down on the page of your map. But we know that line is really pointing up to zero. So which side of the line will the dip go to? We could look at our surface and note the direction of dip, or you can just remember that you're using the right-hand rule, and thus if you put your right thumb in the actual strike direction of 0 degrees, your fingers are pointing in the direction of dip to the east in this case. Draw the small line perpendicular to the strike line in the direction of dip determined. At the end of this dip line, write the dip degree angle from horizontal, and you're done. With that symbol on the map, every geologist or knowing individual will understand the exact orientation of the feature you measured at that location. If your right-hand rule strike is due south, 180 degree azimuth, the strike line is, well, a vertical line. But we put our right thumb down towards the south direction, and now our fingers point to the west, and our symbol is a mirror image of the 0-degree strike. Giving some examples, assuming all have 45-degree dip, this is the symbol for 30-degree strike, 60 degrees, 90 degrees, 120 degrees, 150 degrees, 180 degrees, 210, 240, 270, 300, 330, and 360, which we note is the same as zero. And so use zero as the strike and not 360 to simplify our situation. Now, clearly in nature, we don't always have such perfectly flat and smooth surfaces as our statue example. We often carry map boards or field notebooks with us, and these planar objects can be placed against a more rough or regular plane to give a consistent surface to measure. But what if the only place you can measure a bed is on the bottom of the layer? Right-hand rule works by placing your right hand on top of the surface you are measuring, so if you have to measure a bed from below, you need to place the back of your right hand on the underside of the bed with the fingers downslope, and your thumb again points in the strike direction. As you can see, this will give you the same strike and dip direction as if you'd measured it on top. And if your bed has been overturned, that is, has been tilted so much from original horizontal position that the top is now under the bottom, well, you measure the bed as if it wasn't overturned, placing the palm of your right hand on the upper side of the overturned bed or the back of your right hand on the lower side, as you would a non-overturned bed. However, we let other geologists know this bed is overturned by giving a special symbol on the map, which looks like our previous strike and dip symbol, but with a J curve for the dip, and the curved part of the J is on the back side of the symbol, and the straight part crossing the strike line is pointing in the actual direction of dip. But two more symbols are needed for the two extremes of dip angle, 0 and 90, that is, perfectly horizontal planes or perfectly vertical. A horizontal surface such as this floor of the statue has no strike, as the horizontal plane matches the surface, and by definition of being horizontal, it has no dip angle. In such cases, we make a circle with a plus inside, like so, and tell any other geologist the orientation of the plane here is horizontal. Perfectly vertical planes, like this face of our statue, are the other extreme, and in this case, there is a definite strike direction, but no definite dip direction. In that case, we make a long bar for the strike, like we did with any other dip between 0 and 90, but the dip line becomes a shorter bar bisected by and through the middle of the strike line. You've now told the world the plane you measured here is vertical. I don't have to write the dip is 0 when using this symbol, and I don't have to write the dip is 90 degrees using this symbol. To emphasize again, measuring strike and dip is one of the most fundamental tools in a field geologist's kit, and it is essential if you want to go further in the upcoming episodes of this series that you go out and practice this skill. But the devil's in the details, as usual, of what exactly can be measured with strike and dip, and how we might alter our map symbols to communicate these variously measured features. When out in the field with students, and I see them with compass to rock, I often ask them, what are they measuring? What are you measuring strike and dip on? They better be able to tell me, is it a bedding surface, or a fault or joint surface, or a cross-bedding surface, or whatever. When we come back next time, we look into the devilish strike and dip details here on Earth Explorations.